Yes, Commander, as you wish. Okay, class, now he's gone. Let's get back down to physics. So we're up to electron microscope. So if you look at a traditional microscope here, so the object is placed here. Any light coming parallel through the actual top of the object will go down through the focus of this lens that's placed here. Anything going through the middle of the lens will go straight through. So the light will converge at this point here, and that's where you'll get an image. Okay? And that image there is your first image. There's a second eyepiece in your microscope, and light coming from here going straight through that would actually go straight through, and any light coming parallel to this lens will be diverted through or refracted through the focal length there. Now you can see here the rays are diverging, but if you go back, this is where they appear to come from. So you'll get a real image here, and you can put a screen there and see it, but you get a virtual image that you can see through the lens all the way back here, and it's much larger and it's inverted, it's upside down. So that's a traditional light microscope. The disadvantage of this is that if you've got a very small object, you get light diffracting off those tiny points of the object and it spreads. And so you'll get parts of this point here overlapping with parts from here because it will diffract and it goes through. So you get a spreading of the light and you get two overlapping images coming from different spots on the object but forming an overlapping image. And that's why there's a limit to the resolution using light. The real reason for this is that light has a wavelength of about 10 to the minus 7 metres, so it can't really look at anything under high resolution that's got an order about that size or smaller. So we need something with a smaller wavelength and a way of actually doing a similar thing here. So that's how we look at doing that. So what we need to do is we need to look for something that's got a much smaller wavelength to get higher resolution images. So you could look at other forms of light like X-rays. But unfortunately, X-rays here will interact with the crystal atoms, you'll get further diffraction, you'll actually get the, we've actually seen that with crystals. You'll also find that glass is opaque to X-rays, so we can't really use X-rays effectively here. So another thing we've just learned about matter waves is the fact that electrons have a very similar wavelength to X-rays. So by using those, we can get those to sort of show a high resolution due to its small wavelength of about 10 to the minus 10 metres. So this is one example electron microscope here. We've got an electron gun. It's going to shoot electrons of fairly high energy there, or high momentum, to give them smaller wavelengths to give you much less diffraction and a higher resolution. And that's going to go through a lens. Now, because electrons have got a charge, that's one of its useful properties. So one useful property is it's got a wavelength that's very small, and the other one that's got a charge, so that we can actually use electric fields or magnetic fields as a lens to deviate or exert a force on the electrons and actually bend them to a focus point, okay? And that's something we can't do with X-rays. So here we use a lens there that's magnetic field. It goes through and you get the same sort of, picture as the other one. You've got two lenses going on here, passing it through a specimen, and then we've got electric beam coming through. So it goes down to a fluorescent screen or a camera. So this gives you a bit of a look at the part electron microscope there. I've got off the internet there. So essentially they actually paint these things normally if you're going to do the backscattering one or the reflective one, scanning electron microscope. The stuff comes off the specimen, goes off to the secondary electron storage, but it's essentially a key that you actually understand is being done with magnetic lenses there. Okay. Now electron microscopes will let you see very high resolution images. This is actually individual atoms being used to spell out Star Trek. Okay. By IBM Research. These are red blood cells you can use. Okay? And there's a video here you can watch, all right, where they use it with a copper plate. So we'll insert that there as well. They use a copper plate there, and they actually put carbon monoxide atoms on there. So we put carbon monoxide atoms on here, and the scientists chose the carbon monoxide molecule to move around the copper plate. This one. Use dental floss, and there's some hairs there. And it's important to note here that no matter how big the microscope is, we still can't get down to finding something as insignificant as CAS. Okay? So the advantage of the electron microscope is it's got a much higher resolution, because as you get a point source of light going through a slit or off a very tiny object, you'll get some degree of diffraction here. So rather than the direct beam we want, you'll get diffracting over a range there. Okay? So by using a smaller wavelength, you can minimise that amount of diffraction and get a higher resolution. At the moment, you'll get discs of images there, causing them to overlap, and that's where you get your fuzziness from, so they merge together. So the important thing to note here is electrons have got two useful properties. They've got a much smaller wavelength than visible light, causes less diffraction of the off the objects, and therefore less overlapping of images, much higher resolution. So that's the one thing. The other thing is it has a charge, so you can deflect them by the electric and magnetic fields to do the focusing part. And as I said, we can't use X-rays, so they could have been used, but there's no real way of actually focusing them. Okay? All right, thank you.